Hey everyone, it's Justin again. In this lesson, you're going to learn about conditional statements. Mia has gotten a head start on us here and is already giving us a great first example of a conditional statement. If you watch this video, then you'll learn about conditional statements. Come on, let's jump in so we can start catching up. By the end of this lesson, you will be able to write conditional statements and identify their two parts. First, we'll learn the two parts of conditional statements, and next, we'll complete one practice problem. Conditional statements are sometimes called if-then statements because they generally follow this structure of if something, then something. Does this sentence structure look familiar to you? Maybe you're remembering many of the theorems that we've learned in previous units. Maybe, if you've already started your biology course, you're thinking of the scientific method. This first part, the if part of the sentence, is the hypothesis. The second part of the sentence, after then, is called the conclusion. Let's take a look at this conditional statement about acute angles. If an angle is less than 90 degrees, then it is acute. The hypothesis in this statement is the phrase, an angle is less than 90 degrees. We know this because it follows the word if. The conclusion would be the phrase, it is acute. Can you think of why this part of the statement might be called the conclusion? This should be something that we can conclude is true based on the other half of the sentence. Let's read back through the statement again, this time paying attention to determine if the conclusion makes sense based on the hypothesis. Do I know that an angle is acute if I know that it is less than 90 degrees? Yes, that is definitely true. Let's take a look at another conditional statement. If you live in Seattle, then you live in Washington. Can you identify which part of this sentence is the hypothesis? You live in Seattle is the hypothesis because this is the if part of our sentence. Knowing this, what is the conclusion of this statement? You live in Washington. Mathematicians love to be able to write things as quickly as possible, which creates a lot of shorthand writing and symbols. Conditional statements are a great example of this. We use P to represent the hypothesis, Q to represent the conclusion, and an arrow in the middle to represent implies. This means that we can take the whole concept of a conditional statement and rewrite it as P arrow Q, which we would read as P implies Q. Just like there are different dialects of language all around the world, the same is true for math. You might find some mathematicians who read that arrow in the middle differently out loud, and that's totally okay. But for our course, we're gonna stick with using implies just to be consistent. These sentences look a lot different than the ones we were just looking at, but they are still conditional statements, just written a little differently. Now we have an angle is acute if it is less than 90 degrees, and you live in Washington if you live in Seattle. See how they don't exactly follow the if-then format? There's still a hypothesis and a conclusion here, though. No matter how the sentence is written, the hypothesis will always go along with if. Can you identify the hypothesis and conclusion in each statement? Here are our hypotheses. It is less than 90 degrees, and you live in Seattle. And here are our conclusions. An angle is acute, and you live in Washington. These statements would still be written in shorthand as P implies Q. Even though the conclusion, Q, appears first in the sentence, it comes second when we think about this logically. For example, can I decide whether or not an angle is acute before I know that it's less than 90 degrees? No, I need to know that hypothesis first to logically come to that conclusion. Our directions for this problem say to identify the hypothesis and conclusion in each of the following conditional statements. Let's try the first one together. Cheddar cheese melts if you heat it up. Ugh, this is a funky one. See how it doesn't follow the if-then pattern? Can you still find the hypothesis in this statement? Our hypothesis still follows the if in this sentence. So it's going to be this phrase here. You heat it up. If that's the hypothesis, then what's the conclusion? Cheddar cheese melts. Oh boy, I'm making myself hungry. Here's our next conditional statement. If I am reading a good book, then I am happy. Can you find the hypothesis and conclusion in this statement? This statement was nice and followed the if-then pattern. The hypothesis is I am reading a good book because it follows the if. And the conclusion is I am happy because it follows the then. We have one more of these left. It will get cooler if she turns on the air conditioner. Go ahead and identify the hypothesis and conclusion. Did you notice that the hypothesis is she turns on the air conditioner? And the conclusion is it will get cooler? Well done. You'll do some more practice with identifying hypotheses and conclusions in the practice game after this video. Phew! Did you notice that there were only two numbers that showed up throughout this entire lesson? You'll find that that's going to be the case throughout a lot of this unit. We're focusing on using our critical thinking skills more so than our solving and number skills. The good news is that if you've made it to the end of this lesson video, then you can now identify the hypothesis and conclusion in this statement. You are now on your way to be able to make excellent geometric arguments. See you next time.